Welcome to NewsClick. We have with us once again Major Priyadarshi Choudhury, who is a Shaurya Chakra winner and counter-insurgency expert. But much more than that, he is the joint coordinator and spokesperson of two very important movements. One is the United Front of Ex-Servicemen, and the other is India Unites, a joint front of Kisans and Jawans. Welcome, Major. Major, I'd like to start with what is happening currently in this country. BJP and the right-wing forces are going ballistic, criticizing and condemning people who question the Balakot raid or raise any question regarding the raid. In fact, former chief of the army staff, V.K. Singh, who's now a minister, a junior minister in this government, has gone to the extent of saying that probably we need a surgical strike against all the critics, from politicians, students, to activists, to media, who question the armed forces. Major, as a former soldier and one who's seen service, more than 6 years in Jammu and Kashmir in the 90s. How do you react to this? I mean, do you think civilians have no right, or the media has no right, or the opposition parties have no right to raise any questions of the armed forces in this country?
So let me put it this way. The trigger for the Balakot operation was the Pulwama incident. It was a terrorist incident. We lost 44 of our bravehearts. Subsequently, many more, five others were killed. And during the last time I came here, I had spoken about that we don't need to politicize this issue. This is purely a military matter. And the armed forces should be given the leeway to strike back at a time and place of their choosing, which they did. There's no need to politicize it. This rampant politicization of the armed forces is threat to our democracy and to our nation, and also harms the armed forces. Now, having said that, it is the government and the BJP which is seeking to do this politicization of the armed forces by asking for votes on the back of these operations that the army conducts, whether it was surgical strike, the first one post-Uri, or even now. So once you do that, the country and the rest of the opposition parties will ask you, because you have made it a political issue. It is only but natural that other political parties will question you. Firstly, nobody is doubting the efficacy of the armed forces or whether the strike has happened. But if you take a step back and look at the sequence of events that have happened, within 24 hours of Pulwama happening, BJP posters had sprung up across the country asking for votes. Vote usko do jo surgical strike karega. So they had something up their sleeve. The armed forces were given a task, and as an arm of the nation, they carried out that task. You immediately go on overdrive saying that, forget the real issues of the people, which is across segments, and I'm saying, talking about agrarian distress, unemployment, lack of jobs, jobless growth, armed forces, one rank, one pension, the litany of who's there, student issues, all of that takes a back seat, and you're only harping about that you have taken a strong action, right? Strong action have also happened in the past governments, but nobody saw it fit to politicize the role of the armed forces or a strike for electoral gains. In a democracy, you, if the government and the BJP wants to politicize it, then they should expect that others will ask questions about it. We are not holy cows.
And hard questions.
Whatever it is, you either don't politicize it and let the armed forces do their job, but if you intend politicizing it, you will be countered. It's a natural reaction. You made it an electoral issue. The other opposition parties and the... And having said that, the armed forces are not holy cows. They are an arm of the state. In a democracy, people will question them. But they need not question them on operational elements. But for the first time in the last 5 years, because of this rampant politicization and asking for votes on the back of surgical strikes of one or two or whatever you call it, they have made it. And it is actually, we are playing into their hands. They have not released the data of the strikes, but their control channels, whether it is the media or social media, talk about imaginary fictitious figures of 300, 400, where the armed forces in the briefing have not given out. The Air Chief very clearly said, it is not up to us to tell you how we have conducted the strike. And the opposition parties took it at that. It is the political part, BJP, which is saying 400, 500, and the troll army or the this thing. They are the ones talking about the numbers. So when they talk about the numbers, the other political parties ask them about the efficacy of the numbers. They are not questioning the armed forces. They are questioning BJP. There is the difference. So let's not fall into the trap of false nationalism or imposed narrative onto us. That is what is dreadful.
It's very interesting that while we are talking about the surgical strike 1 and 2, and BJP is trying to take advantage of it to harvest votes in the coming general election. Since January, the ex-servicemen have renewed the protest demanding one rank, one pension. In the light of BJP taking credit for what the armed forces have carried out, how do you read the way in which they have handled the one rank, one pension issue, which has been demanded by the servicemen for a long time? And BJP in 2013, in fact, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 2013 at Rewari is on record promising that if they were to come to power, they would implement it. So, Major, would you like to take our readers, our viewers, through what is the one rank, one pension demand? What has the BJP done? And why is it that in January, you again revived this protest?
So, one rank, one pension, if you look at the historical perspective of it, the initial agitation was started in 84-85 by Lieutenant Colonel Inderjeet. And it's very clear, which there are two elements to it. It says that if a certain individual who is retired from service with a certain rank and has a certain length of service should draw the same pension in terms of, so if, for example, same length of service is important. Yeah. So if a Havaldar has retired in 1988 with 17 years of service and a Havaldar retiring now with the same length of service should draw the same pension. It flows from the cause of natural justice, right? And the second element to it is any enhancement of pension should automatically be passed on to past pensioners. These are the two elements of it. In 2008, General Sadbir launched this agitation during UPA 2, demanding this. He started the agitation, united the ex-servicemen under one umbrella and started the agitation for it. The government ordered a committee under General Kanduri, who's from the BJP, yes, and it was tabled in Parliament in 2011.
And a former army officer.
Yeah. So the principle was accepted and adopted by the Parliament in 2012. The problem was that, again, Congress was, UPA was in power. They did not do a comprehensive viability study based on the recommendations. So initially in 2013, they say allocated 500 crores as a ad hoc allotment allocation from the budget.
You mean 2014, the last budget?
Last one was 50,000 crores. Okay. They scaled it up to 1,000 crores. Again, financial viability had not been done. So in September 2013, the Prime Minister designate promised in front of the United Front of, I think, 4 lakh people there in Rewari. And he promised that when they come, he demanded a white paper on the subject and said, if I come to power, I'll implement it. It did not happen. And so 2015 till June, we waited and we had a series of meetings with the government functionaries, the then Defense Minister Arun Jaitley. When we went to him, we were actually shocked by a statement of his, which said that, and he told a group of people, delegation that had gone there and said, and addressed General Sadbir and said, General Sahab, jo hum politicians, jo चुनाव के टाइम पे जो वादे करते हैं वो सारे निभाने के लिए थोड़ी करते हैं.
He said that.
So we were absolutely shocked. We just walked out and we started the agitation in June, July of 2015. In August 14, 2015, this government lathi charged us at Jantar Mantar. For the first time in the history of this country, veterans who had been protesting peacefully were lathi charged. That drew outrage from across segments of the society. And the anger was so high that the government finally had to do something about it. So they passed an order of 7th of November 2015. But that was not Orop. There were seven anomalies to that. And it's well documented about why it is not Orop. Suffice to say that the financial, the interim allocation which Manohar Parikar Saab had done was for 10,000 crores pending the viability study. When the studies were done, actual Orop entailed only 8,300 crores. This present allocation, or what we call pension enhancement, we don't call it Orop, pension enhancement accounts for 5,500 crores. And the government said, we have given you Orop, which isn't Orop. It is a principle. It's about the fight for justice. It is not about the dole. It is something which is a due, a right to us. Yeah? The difference is only 2,800 crores. Something in the BJP and the government prevents them from giving out that balance. And they did a huge media campaign through controlled media and through the sympathizers within the armed forces saying that, kuch to diya hai. So we say, kuch to diya, if you're satisfied, please go ahead and do whatever you're doing. You don't have to talk about it. This fight is for our boys, right? 98.2% of the ex-servicemen are from the ranks. Today, the person who retired in November in 2014 when Orop was given, and the person who is retired now, a Sipai at the lowest end of the table, the difference in pay difference in pension is 6,700 odd rupees, which is a substantial sum at the grassroots
between
for a Sipai, and we have scaled it up to the rank. Like I said, we are committed to getting this for our boys, and we will continue to raise the ante and drive up political cost for not giving us Orop for that 2,800 crores which is the gap. And we will continue to raise the political cost. And the political cost involves electoral hits. Ex-servicemen, after the Orop agitation fragmented again, a section said, we have got something, past governments have not given us anything, so we should be thankful. We said, we are thankful. We are thankful for the government today, but there is a difference. And the difference is not much. So one-man judicial committee has been pending in the Ministry of Defence for 2 years without seeing the light of the day. So we decided to scale it up and take it on to other sections of society. We as soldiers fight for the country. And it's time that the country fought for us. This imposed narrative, ki Orop to de diya, people asked us. Now, when we scaled up the agitation to farmers, youth, women's organizations, chit fund organizations, a whole other segment knows that this government is lying. Orop has not been given.
What is it so unique about the servicemen that you believe that they are entitled to Orop, which was promised, which is part of of the... What sets you apart?
Okay. So it's the terms and conditions of our service, right? The main criteria here is to maintain the youthful profile of the army. Our boys retire after 17 years, the initial ones. After 17 years, the Sipai or Lance Nayak or nine, they start retiring after 17. So effectively, you will see a boys retiring from at the age of 35 to 42, when their own social responsibilities are at the peak. The children are small, they have to go to school, there is no other second employment in terms of whatever. The conditions are such in the country that there are no jobs. It's almost impossible to find a soldier getting a second job. Anyway, our boys, 90% of our boys come from farming backgrounds. They go back to being farmers. So it's with the Jawan Kisan agitation, it's a symbiotic relationship with us. Now, look at it this way. Because our boys retire early, which is not so in any other service, including the CAPFs, they retire at 58 to 60. So if you compare lifetime earnings, our boys are at a disadvantage. 53% versus, if you can compare a constable of a CRPF or a BSF, his lifetime earnings and one of our Sipais, our boys only get 53%, right? it's the responsibility that the nation owes to this boy for having sacrificed his youth for the better part of his life and looks after him after he is retired.
Now that we are close to elections, and it's going to take place by next month, as ex-servicemen, what do you think needs to be done to ensure that the commitments that have been made to you by Parliament again and again are lived up to?
So, in the mass movement agitations that we run, whether it is the One Rank, One Pension agitation, or when we coupled with India Unites with the Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan agitation, and then when we scaled it up further to students, women's organizations, minorities, chit funds, all of that, we are looking to make a difference electorally. And I'm being very blunt about it. We will make a difference electorally. We are geared up as an electoral or as a political pressure group, which is not in electoral politics. But having said that, we focus around issues, just people's issues, whether it is One Rank Pension, One Pension, or agrarian distress. We focus, keep a focus firmly on people's issues. We build consensus with opposition parties around our issues. We keep the dialogue open with the government.
But what are you demanding of political parties this time, which would be different from earlier?
So, time? The India Unites or the Jai Jawan, there are three sets. We have given a roster of around 15 demands. The main constituents...
Political parties?
To all political parties.
All the political
parties? All the political parties. Farmers have three demands. We have three of our own, ex-servicemen, since we are the principal constituent, and three demands of the youth. Then minorities have a singular demand, chit funds has a singular demand. I can give you that list of 15 odd points that we have issued to all political parties. And these are all low-hanging fruit. And this is something, like, for us, it is One Rank, One Pension, prevention of degradation of officers, which prevents us our boys who are serving. One of the major threats to national security is the lack of officers. 12,000 officers short. Our boys in the units where they authorized 23 to 24 officers per unit are having to make do with 10, 11. So effectively, they don't get time to train with the boys, spend time with the boys, get to know them better. And these are the men, and this is a combat unit. You're supposed to fight or to live and die. You have to lead men into combat. If you don't get to spend time and train with your boys, how on earth are you going to lead these boys into battle? It's all fine to... beat the war drums and say we'll go to war, but there are issues there. There are multiple issues there. I've also given out a manifesto of points that needs rectification by whichever government comes into power, and we will talk about it subsequently. But coming back to your main question, yes, this time onwards we will make an electoral difference. We are not going to wait for 4 years or 5 years to ask questions of the government. We are going to ask every 6 months, regardless of which party comes into power.
Thank you, Major. We'll for this time, we end now. But we'll be covering other issues from time to time, because this is a very important issue for us. And we look forward to having you with us. Thank you for watching NewsClick. If you have any feedback, do get back to us. If you have any suggestion, do write to us.